Thank you all for coming. It is my great pleasure to welcome one more time and almost say goodbye to a very dear colleague and friend, Bre Przestrzelski. Close enough?
Yeah.
Okay, I practice sure. A lot.
Yeah.
I'm not big in reading or rereading people's bios that you can read on her website or in the email that we send with her CV. As most of you know, she has all the proper engineering credentials, all the way from bachelor's to PhD from an amazing institution called Clemson University. She's now a postdoc at the University of San Diego, working in the School of Engineering, trying to help implement the RED grant, which stands for Revolutionizing Engineering Departments at the University of San Diego. She has done amazing work, sometimes the work that other people should be doing, but now felt on her lap. In addition to that, she remains very involved with the design school at Stanford University, doing the kinds of things that she's going to tell us about today. We thought that a more appropriate way to get to know the person here on the stage would be to show her how she skied on Sunday, right? So we went skiing, and to my surprise, she had never seen a pair of skis in the last 24 years. So she had no idea that the ski technology had changed to shape skis and all that. And to even more surprise, it was how amazing and how quickly she learned. Which is a testament of the person on top of the skis, because she is a quick learner, coachable, as she likes to call herself, a true engineer who was willing to understand all the physical concepts, but yet don't call for proof and data. Every time she tried to do that, she fell on the ground. But so here she is. You can tell a lot about the person by
don't
how they perform.
Me. I'm so sorry.
This is
my first time. Wow.
This is the top of Loveland ski area.
All right, for Bree's mom and family, she's skiing at almost 14,000 feet. There she comes.
Look at that technique. And I avoid the children.
I mean, look at that center of gravity right in the middle of the skis.
Very good. Whoa, let's go. And let's do it again.
What you learned 24 years ago, and there she comes. Right there, making those turns, keeping her body straight, her legs.
Just wait, 4 years from now, I'm
going to
be in the Olympics.
There she comes. Right here.
And that's it.
So, Brianna.
Oh, boy. All right. I honestly, please don't judge me by my skiing abilities. That was the first time. You guys have been, it's been amazing to get introduced to your community here at School of Mines over the last few days. I'm honored to talk with you today about something that is really important to me, and that is design and empowering others, and also finding ways to elevate yourself along your life's journey. So that's kind of what I'm going to be talking about today. And today's talk is not going to have a single table or chart or data in it, so yay. You get that all of the time, so I'm just going to be kind of sharing a story with you over the course of the next 40-ish minutes. Hopefully it'll be shorter, but also I'm going to be inviting some audience participation. So we're going to dive right in. And this is a picture that I took right before I left San Diego last week. It's gorgeous, and it was like 65 and sunny. It was hard to leave. However, when I landed here, this was the picture that I took, and just as sunny, just as beautiful, also 65. I've heard that that's a little bit different and unique for this time of year, but I want to ask you all, what differences do you see in this picture, in these two pictures here? What's different?
Mountains.
Mountains, okay. Julia?
Seagull.
Seagull, yeah.
Was the water frozen a little bit?
Yeah, it was. Yeah, that was up at the reservoir up near Boulder. What else? Yeah, I love that you guys are focusing at that horizon. And Greg mentioned it earlier. You're mentioning it now. What is different about that horizon? Flat versus mountains. What does that suggest? What might that suggest? A difference in
elevation.
Say it again, Brenna.
Elevation.
Elevation. Gosh, you're good. I didn't even plant that. So as I traveled from San Diego, which is very much at sea level, up here to about 14,000 feet where I went skiing the other day, there are a lot of things that change over that. And I'm going to ask you all, what does the term elevation mean to you? Say elevation. What does that mean? Hello. Say it again. Height above sea level, yeah. What else could it mean?
Lack of oxygen.
Lack of oxygen, yeah. I'm definitely feeling that up here these last few days. What else? Let's think beyond just the physical sense of what elevation and change in elevation means.
So lift up.
Lift up, a rising up. Okay, yeah. Excellent. So I Googled elevation, and these were correct. Yay, well done. The second one, height above a given level, especially sea level. Good job, Dot. And the action or fact of elevating or being elevated. So what I'm going to talk today about is three different stages that I have identified in this term of elevation. And this is a picture I took the other day, and it just so conveniently worked out with the three stages of elevation that I'm going to talk about today. The first actually starts with you. Okay, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about how I have elevated myself professionally by telling you kind of where I started. And that's not all going all the way back to when I was born in Indianapolis, but when I started at Clemson University back in spring of 2008. This is actually the first picture I ever got of me in my little Clemson, orange Clemson Tigers shirt. And I went to Clemson because they have a great engineering program, and I was told by my parents, you're good in math and science, so you should do engineering. So I went there. While I was there, I also was a rower. And during my time during undergrad, I rowed, I was a rower, and I did bioengineering. Those were the two things I mostly had time for, because with 6 a.m. and 5 a.m. practices 6 days a week, and taking a challenging major like bioengineering, like all of you here, it is very, very strenuous. And I, during my freshman through junior classes, I was taking thermodynamics, biology, heat transfer, all of these courses that I didn't actually see the application of this. I started getting very, very frustrated with this work. I said, you know, I thought I came into engineering to impact lives and be creative, and I didn't feel any of that. And then I entered senior design. And here you have the luxury of this immense luxury of being impacted by design starting your freshman year. That is amazing, and I wish I had had it. Because it wasn't until senior year when I got to partner up with two pediatric surgeons in the area, identify a problem, and actually work over the course of a year to solve it. And what we developed was a chest tube stabilization device. So when you get a thoracic injury, if it's bad enough, they have to drain fluid from your thoracic cavity, and they do that by putting in a chest tube. Now these chest tubes are currently secured just by wrapping sutures around it. It's a really primitive method. Kids rip these chest tubes out. People roll over in hospital beds and they simply fall out. So, and this happens in 30% of the 2.3 million chest tubes that are implanted in the US every single year. So, as a group of four seniors in bioengineering, we created a really simple solution to prevent that chest tube dislodgement. And we did it in a creative way, bringing together different stakeholders. And through this process, we ended up getting our technology licensed. We won a national design competition. And I was like, wow, I actually can be creative in this math and science field. I then realized that I didn't get access and exposure to this until my senior year, and that was a real problem. So when I became a part of the University Innovation Fellows Program, which you have some really great UIFs here on campus, that was really what I was aiming to take on, was how might we infuse and inspire people through design earlier on at Clemson, rather than waiting until their senior year. So I got to go to Stanford and learn from some of the greats at the D school there, and identified gaps on my campus and created programs and classes and curriculum to fill gaps on our campus, not just at Clemson, but even in the external community, looking at high schools and middle schools to empower others through design. So one of the things we started was the DEN. It stands for Design and Entrepreneurship Network. And it was an opportunity for students who weren't just engineers to be innovators, who weren't just business students to be entrepreneurs, but actually giving everyone on campus this opportunity to bring their ideas to the DEN and grow them with help from outside mentorship. So this is now, it started off as a group of 7 bioengineering students who were interested in taking their ideas and moving them forward. And it's now a university-wide program that has history majors sitting alongside English majors, sitting next to civil engineers and finance majors, all looking to elevate their ideas to the next level. So while I was developing this design and entrepreneurship culture at Clemson, I also was doing it in the research lab. So during my master's degree, I'm sorry if you're a little squeamish, this is a cadaveric shoulder. Having been inspired by design during senior design, I know, you don't have to look, it's okay. Just look at those beautiful faces up there instead. I started realizing how much design was impacting the bioengineering field. And this master's project in particular, we were looking at 2 very specific shoulder implant designs. And we were implanting them in cadavers and testing them on an Instron machine to be able to then recommend to these surgeons we were working with of which implant they should implant depending on the population of the patient. And so that was a really very hands-on and real impact that we could see and that I was having in the bioengineering field, which I never thought that I was gonna get. So from there, I decided to stay for a PhD and continue to help grow the design ecosystem at Clemson. And we developed a 3D printed foot orthotic for type 2 diabetics. This is my shoe, but it's a tri-layer system to offload the specific areas of high pressure that oftentimes exist on the plantar surfaces of type 2 diabetics. They can't feel the bottom of their feet. So when there is a blister or something, a callus that develops on the bottom of their feet, they can't actually feel that it's painful. So they input an orthotic into the shoe to offload that pressure in very specific areas. And we developed a 3D printed model of this, so that way it was repetitive. It was able to be repeated so that when they went back into the clinic, it wasn't just magic that was happening. This was something that could actually be repeatable. So this was the design. It went on to win a pitch competition where we were able to further fund the development of the device. And it's not just only in shoes now, we're actually integrating it within prosthetic liners to offload the specific points of areas that receive high pressure in prosthetic limbs. So all that to say, that was a fantastic opportunity for me to elevate myself professionally. And I know that every single one of us in here has at least one of those examples. And I'm now going to invite you to turn to a neighbor and share with them something that you feel you are very proud of that you have elevated yourself professionally. Okay? Just turn to a partner and share.
I'm a mechanical engineering and traditional student. I'm a senior graduating in May. Picked up humanitarian engineering.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
but as a mechanical.
Yeah.
It's a company based out of
Like sort of like the same
I worked in internship as an innovation consultant. I participated in the internship as one of the
seniors. I don't really
say
like my older sister.
Oh, it's so cool. It's, and I mean, we did the summer thing with the U.S. Air Force and supply chain. So that was, I had a little bit of experience with like innovation strategies.
All right, let's bring it back together. Did somebody's partner share something that was really inspiring or surprised them? Yeah, anybody? Or we were all really boring in our professional elevation. All right, so rather than inviting you to share all of the cool things that you just did, I'm gonna ask us, so there's some studies about how there are different learners in a room. You have visual learners, you have auditory learners, you also have kinesthetic learners. And to bring in a little bit of that kinesthetic element, I'm gonna invite you to do something that might seem a little silly. But I'm going to ask you to do it anyway. So thank you for your participation in advance. So I just asked you to share with your partner something that you are very proud of that you feel has elevated you professionally. And the physical act of rising up and elevating yourself is a symbol to yourself of, you know what, I am rising up, I'm elevating myself in my profession. So I'm going to ask you to stand up for yourself. Stand up for something that you have professionally done.
Superhero.
Yeah, and if you want to do a superhero pose, awesome. Okay, excellent. Now give yourselves a round of applause. Congratulations. All right, you may have a seat. So, you now have all elevated yourselves in some way, shape, or form for you. I think that the next step is taking that elevation and now elevating others around you. So now that you have elevated yourself, how can you do that for others? Some of the examples that I can share with you are the others is some students. So I was a teaching assistant for senior design for 4 years at Clemson, where I got to mentor 22 teams every year. And they were partnered with clinicians, they were solving real problems, and they were becoming elevated for themselves. Another second group is that of faculty. And this is actually a picture from the teaching and learning studio that Myrna just was at Stanford University back in January, where we host about 40 faculty 3 times a year from around the world and teach them how to utilize design thinking to better engage their students, better engage their peers at their university, and actually make meaningful change. So, elevating others, such as faculty. I had the incredible opportunity to do this in the country of India. Last summer, we went and pictured here is students, faculty, administration. We were brought to India by Google, actually. They felt that if we could teach their faculty and students and administrators how to be innovative, they would actually become the most innovative Android developers. So there was a little bit of some very much national pride in this, and I loved getting to know these students and these faculty and administrators in a very different way. And I saw this elevation happening in every single person that we touched there. This is one of my most favorite examples. In August of 2016, I got the chance to go to Tanzania, which is where Hannah's gonna get to go next year. And I taught over 100 students at Arusha Technical College. I was there for 2 weeks, and we were teaching them about the design thinking process. They were all studying to be biotechnicians, and in the country of Tanzania, there were about 4 biotechnicians positions available. There were 100 students, 43 of them were graduating seniors that year, trying to fill 4 positions that were already filled. If you do the math, that's not going to work out very well, but when I asked the students, you know, what are your hopes and dreams? What are you aiming to be? And they said, I'm going to be a biotechnician. So I invited them to utilize their engineering problem solving skill sets to solve some really important challenges that they face every single day. And those are things like access to healthcare, access to education, poverty and corruption. And these students transformed from being just biotechnicians to saying things like, I'm an innovator, I'm an engineer who's supposed to solve these challenges and problems around me. They weren't just gonna be biotechnicians, they were gonna be innovators. And through this work, you know, they weren't these people who grew up that said, oh, you can do whatever. You can do whatever you set your mind to. And so changing them from this mindset of just, I have to be what I've been trained to be, to something so much larger, that was really, really impactful for me to see with some of these students. I just recently relocated down to the University of San Diego, where, as Juan mentioned, it's my goal to integrate social justice into the traditional engineering curriculum. And we're doing that by way of creating these creating these creative modules that can be implemented into hard technical classes like heat transfer, thermodynamics, materials science, that you could learn everything from a textbook. But are you really learning it, and are you seeing the human in it? That is the question that we're trying to answer. And so one of my favorite examples takes us into the material science classroom from last semester. And we had 32 students save a week's worth of trash and bring it into class with them one day. And that's only four of the 32 bags, but it was this huge pile at the front of the room. And as soon as they started opening the bags, it started smelling really bad in there. And actually that was one of the main comments from these students was like, wow, 32 students worth of trash just from one week smells really bad. Let's think about the larger impact of that. Let's think about those islands and those mountains worth of trash. What does that smell like? So we had these students bring in their trash and we invited them to sort it. Now, I don't know if you've ever tried to sort your trash, but there are pieces that can be easily recycled. There are those that are not. And where the conversation led to was these engineers get the opportunity and they have the responsibility to ask, you know, what is the end cycle, what is the end of life cycle for this product look like? Where is it going to go? How can we design products that can be easily sorted, that aren't going to be put directly into a landfill and contribute to this constant pollution and this smell, but actually have a better impact on the environment? So that's one example of how we're trying to integrate some social justice and social context into hard traditional classes. So through this, I think that in addition to elevating myself, I'm elevating others through this impact, through this design and learner's mindset that we're trying to implement in all of our, in all of the learners and people that we're touching. So that's stage number two. And I'm gonna invite you to turn to your same partner, and I want you to share with them something that you feel that you have done to elevate others, okay?
We set goals at the beginning of the semester, and one of our primary goals was just to increase we're starting to we see a lot of freshmen. I've heard about it.
And you know, like, I guess, what was impossible? Like,
you know, it's like I think it just being passionate and inspired by what you're hearing. Oh, really? Yeah, so in their situations, people may not agree with you. Yeah, passionate and excited about it. Oh, yeah, I mean, like, I'm totally exhausted, but I'm like so excited that, well, she's doing, she's trying to figure out how to touch a and she asked me, because it's actually the innovation she's asked me to help her try to get started.
So when I was at Minnesota, I played basketball and I did track and field, so I shared it with my track.
So let's bring it back together. So whose partner shared with them something inspiring about them elevating others? Yeah. All right. Awesome. Anybody care to share what their partner shared with them? One.
She confessed that she elevated many of her peers in high school by tutoring chemistry.
Awesome.
Actually, kids who came to her hating the subject, but after she she did her tutoring, she actually came to appreciate chemistry and understand it.
Awesome. Great. Who else? I saw a lot of hands raised. Yeah, Greg?
Sure. So Werner had a student who you were on her committee. Yeah, PhD committee back a while ago, and helping her through like issues and these kinds of things along the way, and is now, what did you say?
Provost
at UC Riverside, where Werner was before and where she did her PhD. So just kind of mentoring along the way.
Yeah, definitely. How about anybody here in the front?
Oh, I'd like to share.
Okay. Let's see, then we'll hear from a student next. So, whoever wants to volunteer.
Wolf, I just met him. Wolf, he's a Schultz scholar, and he was explaining to me the different goals and projects that he's doing through Schultz and humanitarian engineering, as well as the effort to passionate and aware about what is humanitarian engineering about. And I said, do you feel any pushback from, you know, the community here about humanitarian engineering? And it's actually the opposite effect. With his passion, more people has gone to him to talk about innovation and design in humanitarian engineering. So kudos to you.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yes. Excellent. One more. I'm looking over here. I saw you guys talking, so I know you had something to say about this. Yeah.
Okay. She's in the. It's Cassie.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. She's one of the leaders in the backcountry club here, and she likes showing others, and especially other women here at this college, like their passion in that area.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you for doing that. It's so needed. And I think, so there's a reason why I had you share out your partner's elevation during this session versus the first one. And I'll let you think on why that might be. But I'm going to have us now, again, kinesthetically stand. But this time is hopefully going to be a little different because you're not just standing for yourself, you're standing for those around you. Okay? So let's stand for those around us. Okay. All right. We can give ourselves a round of applause. Yeah. Okay. Let's stay standing. And I want to hear from you, what was different about standing this time versus the first time? Yeah.
How powerful. Like, I was representing people around me.
Wow. That's cool. That is cool. Anybody else?
More celebratory?
Yeah.
There you go, people.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not just about yourself at that point. What else? How about over here? Anything different between that first and second stand? Yeah, Hannah.
I felt like less unsure because the first time I didn't know if you were going to make us do something. More confident, I guess.
Got it. Great. Well, I'm going to invite you to have a seat again. Thank you. This is my first time prototyping this type of thing, and I think it's really interesting to see subconsciously how this framing of doing a simple act of standing and elevating yourself can change with different framing. So the last one, and that is actually a slight combination of the first and second, and that is elevating your entire life and the lives of those around you. And what I find is that in elevating myself and elevating those around me, you almost are becoming a role model, and you're bringing people along with you on this journey to try new things and to elevate themselves in many different ways. And a perfect example of that is, so I just recently moved to San Diego, and I decided that I was going to try surfing because that's what all Southern Californians do. This is my first day trying on a wetsuit in the dressing room, and I was so excited to get out there. I walk out on this beach with this board, and I'm like, I feel really cool because I'm in Southern California surfing. I was surfing at that point, right? No, because I go out into the waves. And one, I didn't realize that low tide did not mean that the waves were easier. No, they are not easier. And in fact, I learned that immediately because I got hit in the face with the board just trying to get out into the water. The board and I did not get along super well. We'll put it that way. Got hit in the head and the temple with it into the side of the ribs. And by the time I very inconfidently, without confidence, I walked out of that water in my wetsuit. I was still a surfer. I had tried. And I survived. I'm here today. But there was something really special about putting myself into that learner's mindset, trying something new, and elevating myself in a way that I had never done before. So that learner's mindset, yeah, I'm still trying to surf. I go out as much as I can. That learner's mindset is something now that is taking over this new experience for me down in San Diego. I'm trying on how to rollerblade. Mind you, I put a screenshot of a video in here, not the actual video, because it's really bad. I'm kind of stumbling, but it's a lot of fun to put yourself in these new situations and actually learn something. And then a perfect example is just the other day when Juan took me up to Loveland and I tried something new again for the first time and fell only a few times, and I'm still feeling like I got in a car accident because, man, my shoulder hurts and my neck is killing me. But I feel just so much more elevated in a very, very different way than I ever have before. And what you'll notice is as you start putting yourself in these situations and elevating yourself professionally for yourself and for others, you're bringing others along with you, and others are bringing you along with. And that's Juan on our trek. So what I found through this is that yes, it's one thing to kind of elevate yourself and do these actions, but it's also important to have these goals. So this clicker, there we go. Okay, so these are the three stages that I've identified. And as I was planning this on my big classroom size whiteboard at home, I noticed a goal that I'd written on the top of my whiteboard literally this is the talk that I'm talking through today. And then up at the top is something I'm going to zoom in here. And it's a goal that I wrote up there on the whiteboard probably 3 years ago now. And it says, travel the world and leave a positive impact wherever I go, doing something that hasn't been done before that needs doing. And I don't know why I wrote it, but it's at that point when I wrote it, I was like, I was really struggling. I was like, I don't even know. Yeah, I didn't have much direction. I needed something to just write down and set that goal in place to be able to know where I was elevating myself to. And I'm going to invite you to do that today. And I'm going to invite you to think about your own life elevation goal. And some of you have a sheet of paper, some of you don't. Write it down. You don't have to share it, but I'm going to invite you to just think about it. It's a goal. It's not that this isn't something that you're going to be tested on or you have to stick to, but it is something to remind yourself every day of why you're doing what you're doing. So I'm going to give you a couple minutes to do that. So go ahead and wrap up that goal. And one last time, I'm going to ask you to stand. And this time, it should be a little different than the first two, because this time you're going to be standing for yourself and for others, what you aim to be and what you hope to inspire in others around you. Okay? Let's stand. All right. And with that, that's the end of my talk. So, thank you all very much. And I'm going to give you guys a round of applause for participating and give yourself a hand. So, I'm available for questions. I think we got like 20-ish minutes for questions. Happy to answer anything. Yeah, feel free to have a seat. But thank you for the opportunity to talk. And I know it was a little different than probably a normal lecture style talk, but I don't do normal. It's too boring for me. So, questions, comments, fits of rage, complaints. Of course, Juan.
What I've begun to see in these presentations and other conversations that we had, I've been studying the engineering curriculum and what it does to students as people. And usually in a very technical curriculum where you do a lot of problem solving, the way we do it in statics, thermal, fluids, and all the engineering science, is that it forces to split ourselves between the person that knows how to solve problems over here and could get very good at it and get a good grades, and then the other person, the one that has emotions and political interest and artistic inclinations and all that over here, but those two things, those two spheres of life shall not mix, right? And what is interesting about your presentation is it seems that from very early on, from your days at Clemson, that perhaps you struggled with that and you tried to find a way to bring these two spheres of your life together. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And design plays a very important role in that process.
Yep.
Anyway, it's more a comment than a question. That's what I saw.
Great, thank you. Yeah, I just to add on that, I was talking with I think the dean or the president earlier today, and I was telling sharing with them that I didn't feel. So the word creative is a word that a lot of engineers don't feel connected to. Being creative means that you are an artist, you're a musician, that is what creative means. And I grew up playing an instrument, I grew up playing sports, I loved doing pottery and painting. And then my parents were like, math and science, you should do this. And so I was still trying to find that creative outlet. And I guess it was through design that I saw this little spark of like, oh, maybe I can still be creative. And that is something that I think we in the engineering program here have that opportunity to showcase, is that everyone is creative in a lot of different ways. You might not have the best art skills, or you might not be the best musician, but you're creative just by being here at Mines and the things that you're doing every day. So, yeah.
Well, for you, where does innovation live on that spectrum between creative and critical, or is it like a state of jumping back and forth, or like where do you drop it?
Yeah, so the word innovative and creative to me are very, very similar. I think that it has to do a lot with the language of the people you're talking to. Creative, if you say the word creative in certain environments, people immediately shut down. They're like, we don't do creativity here. That's not something we do. That's fluffy. But if you use the word innovative, that's a completely different story. And so I think that they are very much one and the same. It's about creating something that is of value that people, that hasn't been done before. And that people can appreciate. And with respect to on the critical versus creative scale, I think that there's critical elements of being creative and technical elements of being creative. I know a professor at Stanford who's written a book called Ingenious, who actually, she has techniques on how people can actually be more creative. Mm-hmm. And she's implementing those into her classes at Stanford, it's completely innovative work. She's working with students who say, they come in the first day and they're like, I'm here to prove that you cannot make me creative. And by the end of the time, they're realizing, wow, actually creativity is not what I thought it was. Yeah, does that answer your question? Cool.
Well,
you're good.
Can I do it? Yeah. I think that another word that we'd like to innovative, there's a number of other ones that are on Minds Without Borders.
Oh, no, yeah, I talked to them earlier. Thank you guys for coming.
Yeah,
bye. Thank you.
Another word that we like to attach to like the graduate engineering graduates is like critical thinkers. Wolf mentioned the word critical before, mm-hmm. also. What is that, like, ideally, if somebody's graduating, they're a critical thinker. What does that look like to you in light of all of this?
Somebody who is not afraid to take on really hard problems. I think that would be, a critical thinker. I'm not sure that there's a proper definition for it, but if I had to describe a critical thinker, it's somebody who's unafraid to take on really big challenges. And there are tons of ways to approach problems, problem solving, and I think that a critical thinker is somebody who can break all of those down, no matter the size of the problem, to actually create meaningful solutions in that space. Maybe. I don't know. I don't do research in critical thought, but that would be what I would. That's how I would define a critical thinker, or a way to do it on the spot. Yeah, Julia.
What are you most excited about elevating next?
Great question.
I mean, you're done with life. But
yeah, I know, and it's up to space, right? these are all three things that we're constantly innovating and elevating within. I'm nowhere near done elevating myself and others, and just like being a role model and allowing others to be role model and mentor to me. I think one of the things that I'm most excited about is doing this on a larger scale and impacting even more people. I've shared with now many of you here in the room that it's my goal to transform the relationship between design and communities. And a lot of times we take, we go into communities and we design for them, and there's a little bit of co-creation in this process, but I think if we can empower the people in these areas, developing areas both domestically and international to solve these problems on their own, that's where I think we can actually make scalable and sustainable change. And that's one of my goals. It's been one of my goals now for like 4 years to do something in this space, whether it's inside a university or a startup or something. That's where I see, me going. Yeah, so. And also learning how to ski and snowboard and not fall down so much. Yeah. Yeah,
so one. Another comment is your progression there, and maybe with one between others and life with communities and their environment. I just had this idea that could be the progression that informs and inspires the integrated design studios mm-hmm. in the Bachelor of Science mm-hmm. that we're developing here. So you start with the first year with you, the mm-hmm. person. Then second year others, the third year community and environment, and the fourth year would be life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I would love to see that progression.
Well, we're gonna have to get another picture with two more mountains in there then. that's clearly the only thing to do. Yeah, actually, this was a funny picture that I took on our way up to Loveland just the other day, and I forgot to mention it during the presentation. I was initially just going to draw like three zigzags and call it the first one you, second one others, third one life. And then I like was looking through my pictures and I was like, oh, this is really interesting, because oftentimes when people, they're focusing just on themselves and then they stop there. And I was like, sometimes stopping and reflecting on that is good, but there are other people who just stop at that point and they don't move on from that. They're only focused solely on themselves. And then again, maybe if they do move into this next stage, maybe they stop here. I just thought that was kind of interesting, the way that picture worked out. Yeah, I didn't plan for that. Yeah, Marina.
In your front slide, you said something about like child at heart. What do you mean by that?
What's your question? So on my first slide, I have Bre Przestrzelski, PhD, child at heart. The reason I put that one is because I actually really don't like putting PhD after my name. If people call me doctor, I actually ask them not to, for a lot of reasons, but I felt that I needed to put that on there. But also I wanted to add a little bit of actually who I really believe that I am. And that's somebody who doesn't want to grow up, is constantly learning, constantly curious, constantly asking why, and has this childlike wonder about the world that's going on around them. And that is so important to people who want to change the world. I think that we lose that so quickly. And we got to sit and remind ourselves every now and again that it's okay to not know all the answers and to ask why and be curious. Yeah, that would be why. And the reason why I don't like having PhD after my name is sometimes it creates this immediate barrier when talking to other people that they aren't as smart as you. And I am not, I used to say, I can't say it now because people have told me not to, but I say I'm not smart, I just work hard. And they're like, oh no, you have a PhD, you have to be smart. And what that title sometimes does is it creates this barrier that people can't have a conversation with me. And so I like to sometimes just leave that off and like say, hey, we're talking the same language. Let's relate to each other in that way that is very common and can allow each other to grow. So, yeah.
So also on that title, sorry to hog, but also on that title, you said elevation through design.
Mm-hmm.
So what is your definition of design? Because you see it in you, others, and even at life.
Mm-hmm.
So
I don't have a definition of design. I think that it is something that is very fluid. It's like a design is it's similar to creativity. It's like creation of something. But it, so many people try and put definitions on this design thing, and I think that once you start labeling things and putting them into these buckets, it actually limits other people from reaching that and seeing that design applies to them. And so design is an all-encompassing creation of something cool. I don't have a proper definition of it, and I think it should be, it could be kept that way, and allows access to this space to people who might define design in a different way.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yes?
So why did you choose bioengineering?
Good question. Sometimes I ask myself that, even today. I chose bioengineering because I said, I had a lot of mentors that were telling me, you're good in math and science, you should do engineering. And I chose bioengineering because I saw the impact on people so much more immediate than I did with civil, with mechanical, like all the other options at Clemson. I didn't feel had that immediate human touch and impact. And I also had this grand vision of becoming a neurosurgeon, and I thought, oh, that would be a great major to do leading up to it. I really like blending the science with the engineering, and that was something that was very unique. So at Clemson, there were two tracks. There was bioelectrical and biomaterials. And if you were bioelectrical, you took a lot of electrical engineering classes, as well as these bio classes, so biology, chemistry, all of these. And then if you took biomaterials track, you took a lot of materials classes and mechanical classes, as well as the bio track. So that part I liked also because it was the integration. It was like a center point of you know, not just one discipline, it was bringing multiple people together. So I liked that. And also some really unique research opportunities in that. And the faculty that I got to meet before coming to Clemson, those that I met in bioengineering were by far the most impactful in the hour or two that I got to meet with them. So I noticed that there was a family aspect within the department that didn't exactly exist a lot of the other places I visited. Yeah. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Cool. Anybody else?
Did you notice the moon in your picture?
Thank you so much for pointing that out. Yes, it is the period. I tried to place it. Gosh, I can appreciate a person with an eye for detail. Yeah. Cool. All right. Well, if there aren't other questions in front of the group, feel free to reach out to me. My Twitter name is up there, as well as my terribly long email that I tried to get to change at San Diego, and they said, oh, you know, we'll only change it if the first, there's only 26 letters or less. And I was like, what? Are you kidding me? Who would deal with a 26 letter email address? But yeah, I'm right there. So feel free to reach out. Thank you so much for coming. And I think it's officially the end of the day. So thank you guys. Yay.